Prince Edward Island, located in the southern part of the Gulf of St. Lawrence, is by far the smallest of the Canadian provinces. The island is only 200 kilometers long by roughly 30 kilometers wide. Yet its coastline, which measures 1,260 kilometers, is vital to the island economy. During the summer, these shores are among the most intensely used in Atlantic Canada because of the warmer inshore waters and extensive sand beaches. Selected beaches provide the only local source of aggregate for the island construction industry. Many of the estuaries are prime aquaculture sites and biological nesting habitats, and small fishing harbors dot the entire coastline. Ship traffic to and from the island is not extremely heavy. Nevertheless, in the event of a marine oil spill, the impact on the island economy could be severe. Low-altitude oblique aerial video of the Prince Edward Island coastline was completed in two stages. Initially, the Northumberland Strait shore from Sea Cow Head to Hillsborough Bay, including the Charlottetown Harbor area, was videotaped on November 10, 1988. The remainder of the island was completed 2 years later, on October 12 to 13, 1990. A total of 8 hours of aerial video using 3/4-inch videotapes was shot from a Canadian Coast Guard helicopter. Flying height was generally kept between 100 and 150 meters at a distance of about a half a kilometer from shore, except where coastal fog and rain forced the helicopter to reduce its altitude. The flying speed generally varied between 60 and 90 knots. Videotaping coincided with low tide stage whenever possible in order to document the maximum extent of the intertidal zone. Interpretive commentary provided on the videotapes highlights the physical character of the coast, the anthropogenic activities in the coastal zone, and some biological observations made during the flights. The field commentary has been edited in places to clarify geographic locations and to add further information about a particular stretch of coast. The coastline of Prince Edward Island is low-lying with elevations exceeding 20 meters in only a few areas. The general configuration of the shoreline is dominated by the underlying geologic structure, while a detailed coastal morphology is a product of dynamic forces such as winds, waves, tides, currents, and sea ice. Where the coastline parallels the geologic structure, such as along the west and northeast part of the island, the shoreline is straight. In contrast, where the geologic structure is perpendicular to the coast, such as along eastern PEI, erosion along the fold axes has produced a very indented coast. Similarly, the large bays such as Malpac Bay have resulted from erosion along the broad northeast-southwest structural axes. The coastal zone is composed of either sediment or soft recessive bedrock, which means that rates of shoreline change are rapid. Erosion rates are commonly half a meter to a meter per year, according to an air photo study in 1988 by the PEI government. Owens, in an earlier study, provides a detailed description of the coastline. He divided Prince Edward Island into 8 coastal environments on the basis of processes, geomorphology, and resultant shore zone sediment transport systems. The northeastern coast consists of mainly low rocky cliffs, with only a few pockets of sand beach and a moderate-sized barrier beach across the front of North Lake. In contrast, the remainder of the north coast is characterized by extensive sandy barrier beaches with large coastal dunes fronting several broad embayments. Between the embayments are cliff shores which attain heights of 30 meters at Orby Head. The famous PEI National Park includes a large portion of this coastal environment. Although the tidal range is only about a meter, higher wave energy conditions and an abundant sediment supply have produced dramatic shoreline changes, particularly at the tidal inlets which cut through these barrier beaches. Low bluffs, mixed sediment beaches, marshes, and extensive peat deposits are found along the inner shores of Malpac and Kaskumpek Bays. The West Coast constitutes a third coastal environment. It is reworked by high energy waves which transport sediment primarily in a southward direction. The coast is predominantly rock cliffs of 5 to 10 meters relief, with barrier beaches fronting only a few small estuaries. Closer to West Point, wider sand beaches with larger dunes occur as a result of increased sediment input from the north. Egmont Bay is characterized by low unconsolidated shores with extensive marshes and mudflats at the head of the bay. Submerged sandy shoals exist along much of the outer bay, and several low degraded barrier beaches are found along the western shore. Along Northumberland Strait, rocky shores form the outer coast, and unconsolidated mixed sediment beaches fringe the inner parts of the bay, such as Bedeck Bay. Large barrier beach systems such as those on the north coast are absent because of the smaller wave regime and scarcity of sediment. Farther to the east, the coastline consists of a very pronounced crenulate pattern of rocky headlands and coves with extensive intertidal flats. These flats are covered by distinctive low parallel sandy bed forms. Coastal Environment 6, Hillsborough Bay, has a complex shoreline with both low mixed sediment beaches and rocky cliff shores. Marshes fringe the upper part of many of the small river estuaries. The Hillsborough River is the largest of the estuaries, and it's the largest of three drowned river valleys which coalesce at Charlottetown Harbor. The southeast coast of PEI is characterized by bedrock and unconsolidated cliffs up to 25 meters relief. Large sandy beach complexes are few, with the largest occurring at Wood Island. The east coast is very picturesque, with broad, shallow estuaries, partially enclosed by barrier beaches and separated by bold headlands. Just south of East Point, several spectacular barrier beaches occur, and some of the largest wooded dunes on PEI are found here. Aerial coastal video coverage begins at Graham Pond and proceeds along the beautiful barrier shore of Panmure Provincial Park, Panmure Island, and the inner shores of Cardigan Bay and the smaller bays of Sturgeon and Clark's Bay, and along the inner estuarine shores of the Montague River, Brudenell River, where we passed by the famous golf course of the same name, past Georgetown, and into the Cardigan River estuary as far inland as the town of Cardigan. Many of these shores are very low and sometimes marsh-like. We pass by the town of Newport and then proceed into Launching Bay and along the inner and outer shores of Boughton Island, then following the coastline northward into Boughton Bay and Boughton River estuary. Coming up on the harbor at Graham Pond, it's probably the harbor for Gasparilla and Pembroke. You can see a riprap on either side of the controlled entrance. The good size sand beach fringing on either side of it with, you can see piles of beach material by a beach mining operation. Headland here, I would guess, to be about 10, 12 meters high, maybe, unconsolidated sediment over bedrock. It's not a very wide intertidal, only 20, 30 meters at most. We're at Terrace Point. Old dune, somewhat of a sharp foredune crest, and extensive fringing sand beach. A short section of low cliff, half of it's unconsolidated overlying bedrock, and then we hit the barrier linking Panmure Island, a very popular recreational beach. Here's a good view of the Panmure Island barrier. And see the Panmure Island lighthouse at the end. It's an extensive sand barrier linking the island. There's one, possibly two sandbars offshore. You see some small blowouts, but it's a single, pretty well a single dune ridge. We're just at about a little over 500 feet here now. We're just coming on the Panmure Island now. You can see some maybe bedrock sticking out just as you get onto the island through the sand beach. Somebody's just moving into the end of Panmure Island. The lucky fellow's got a pool, a really nice place here. Erosion rate along here is reported to be fairly high, up to a foot a year, and as the lighthouse may well find out. Shot number 29 of the Panmure light. Now we've got fairly bright sunshine, but essentially along here we've got a bedrock cliff, unconsolidated sediments, 1 to 3 meters thick over type of bedrock, total cliff height. Anywhere 8 to 12 meters I'd guess. Considerable riprap or coarse material at the base, not being carried away by any waves, and very little beach development on the outer coast. As we come around the backside of Panmure Island, we're getting away from the cliff and into more progradational features and ridge and runnel development in the intertidal. There you can just see some of the intertidal sand flat. Some seals here as well, and just they fringe a recurve spit that's the trees are sitting on what look to be glacial material and some old dune, and then there's a small barrier curving around into the bay. Small wharf at the inner part of Panmure Island. Looks like it's privately owned. The inner part of the island is a low sand beach. Back shore is either a low scarp at where the trees are or a marsh vegetation. Intertidal is quite extensive in places. It's bedrock in the base with a thin veneer of sand and kelp vegetation. Promontory you see there is an old, what looks to be an old wharf or a groin. Got some old crib work still in it. Road used to run down to it. And pretty well all along the outer part of Panmure Island on this side, it's a fringing sand beach. Some intermittent dune. The white at the top, I don't believe it's gravel, it appears to be more vegetated mat. On the backside of the barrier, you've got some riprap. I think it's been put in there. Probably protect the road that goes across to the island. Again, there's some more aquaculture here in St. Mary Bay. There's quite a few of these promontories that stick offshore. They're all old wharves or breakwalls. They're in disrepair, usually quite coarse riprap and crib work left behind. But the shore, wherever you, it's a little hard to see with the lighting, but the trees are sitting on a low glacial drift. Oh, probably 1 to 4 meters high. Probably a mixed sand and gravel fringing beach with some bedrock outcrop in places. Certainly the vegetation of the dark areas at the lower intertidal indicate that there might be some rock there. Sort of looking at the inner part of St. Mary's Bay. Another spit extending off of this headland. It's much more glacial material in this whole area than we've seen in other parts of Prince Edward Island. Time is 14:15 and it's October 13th, 1990, and we've been flying at about around 400 to 500 feet. Low scarp just beneath the trees. Sand beach with sand and gravel in the lower intertidal. Just coming up on a wharf in Sturgeon Bay. There's no real name to it. It's actively being used today. You can see the riprap on either side of it, fringing sand beach. And looking into Sturgeon Bay at the head of it, it's a low-lying shore. There's the Highway 17 going across it. Vegetated in some spots, but mainly a fringing sand beach. The intertidal, low shoreline, and at the point here as you're just coming into view you can see some dune ridges wrapping around the end of the promontory. This small embayment, primarily sand shore, mixed sand and gravel in the intertidal, and intermittent low scarp and marsh. Again, at each promontory, we've got recurved spit, some dune development, but very low relief. Coming up on the Georgetown Harbor. Should be coming up on a light day. Yes, there it is.
Coming into view is the St. Andrews Point Provincial Park, low scarp, and the Whiteman's Point Lighthouse. And there's quite a few seals jumping in the water.
Actually sitting on a rock promontory that extends quite a ways off the point. What?
nice property. Oh, and into the Georgetown Harbor, there's a ferry that crosses over to Georgetown in this area. There's some what looks to be aquaculture or some other type of fishing in the area. The shoreline itself is a low erosional scarp, less than 4 meters, probably 1 to 3. Sandy intertidal with intermittent bedrock. Here you've got an old break wall that's been attached by a sandy barrier. Just see the crib work falling apart at the end. The shore, for the most part, is sand. This is sort of a dry vegetated mat at the upper storm limit. Some rock. The scarp here is probably 4 to 5 meters. Beach width, maybe 20, 25 meters. Again, a couple old wharf break wall structures. And like we saw at the Murray River estuary, you're seeing sort of alternate spit on either side of the estuary as you work your way down. So it's got to be probably a wave. Wave dynamics. Good view there of looking down the whole estuary. Past Lower Montague and on to Montague. Difficult to see the shore, so I'll just describe it. It's low erosional scarp. Occasionally it's getting up maybe 5 meters in height. Sand, fringing sand beach. Some dune grass where you've got these low spits. Intertidal is not very wide. And there's really only marsh in the little coves. To be some gravel mixed in with the sand near the bars or the spits. Yeah, on the inner part of some of these ridges or spits extending off into the estuary, you can see some ideas that there might be bedrock or coarse substrate to them. These tree shores are all bluff backshore, narrow sandy beach with an intertidal of both mixed sand and gravel. And the shore is pretty well the same all the way up to Montague. Just getting a view up into Montague right now at the bridge, fishing fleet. Time is 14:25 Atlantic Daylight Time. Flying at 500 feet, roughly 70 to 80 knots. And we're just heading over to the Montague River estuary. Shoreline is a vegetated glacial cliff, scarp, fringing sand beach with occasional sandy spits with some coarse material along the lower intertidal. Marsh is not that common in this estuary. There's a few coves with some marsh vegetation. Scarp heights anywhere from 1 to probably 5 meters at maximum in places. Just looking at the spit and cliff at Brudenell Point at the mouth of the Montague River, the cliff is unconsolidated, roughly 5 to 8 meters high. There's a dirt road access to it. The intertidal is much coarser around the promontory, Pebble Cobble Boulder, and right at the mouth here we're getting quite a bit of aquaculture. That's the end of film 16. Heading up the Brudenell River estuary, and it's similar to the Montague River estuary. It's got a treed scarp in the back shore, fringing sand beach, and occasional sandy spits extending offshore. Where you get to those spits again, you get a little bit more coarse material extending off the promontories. That's probably okay. Yeah, looking towards the head of the estuary, again, you're getting a bit more marsh than we got at the other estuary. And you're getting what appears to be more coarse material. Sort of bedrock controlled or coarse controlled ridges. And the picture now is part of the Brudenell Provincial Park, which contains a fairly large golf course and a picnic area, motel, and so on. It's quite a recreational area. along this side of the shore, it's a lower shore than the other side. The intertidal is probably less than 50 meters wide, mixed sand and gravel, and here you've got an island in the middle which has quite a substantial scarp to it, probably up to 5 meters coarse material around the intertidal, and then it's joined by what looks to be an artificial break wall. Most of the shoreline has got a treed scarp in the back shore, anywhere from 1 to 4 meters high. A intermittent beach development with an intertidal of sand and gravel. Much more unconsolidated glacial deposits along this whole shore area. A lot of aquaculture in the estuary at the mouth. And we've got accretionary spits at intermittent distances along the estuary. We're just coming up on the Georgetown. Just come into view. You see some of the shoreline here has been protected by artificial means, particularly at the wharf. There's a couple groins sticking offshore. There's a ferry boat tied up. One and two of Georgetown. A little bit farther seaward, just switch into a barrier spit complex fronting a marsh. Low dune, pretty well single ridge with a, it's anchored to a couple old pockets of glacial material and bedrock. Less than a couple of meters high. On the outer head, Georgetown, we're in erosional scarp. Unconsolidated material shows up as a little lighter color on the monitor. Over bedrock, but the slope wash is covering much of the bedrock. Intertidal is intermittent rock, sand, gravel. Farming right down to the back shore. The height I'd estimate is about 3 to 4 meters. Bedrock exposed offshore, vegetated with various types of seaweed. See the road ending here, it's been eroded away. It's a little hard to see, but it's still a low erosional scarp. Sandy upper tidal, mixed sediment, boulder to sand, and the lower intertidal. We're just heading up the Cardigan River estuary. It's quite a prominent barrier spit extending off offshore, and some smaller ones as you get farther up the estuary. The scarp along here would be estimated at probably 8 meters, possibly as high as 10 in places. And then it lowers down to this spit, dune grass, and some marsh vegetation in behind the barrier. A good shot of it there. You can see the sand, sand plain, sandy tidal flats in the back part of the estuary. Just went by one of these old wharf structures or crypt structures that extended offshore. And another small spit extending off off the point.
This small foreland with the road access is known as Morrison Beach.
White-colored material you see at the top of the beach appears to be a vegetated mat. Again, here we've gone into intermittent erosional scarp. The people here at these houses have put a crib work in front of their house. Fringing sand beach, intertidals sand with some coarse substrate. A few coarse rocky shoals off further offshore. You just got a view of one of the higher bluffs along this area of a 10 meters high. Looks like it might be an old part of an old glacial complex. And again, another barrier or a spit extending offshore across a what looks like to be a bedrock-based feature. Some marsh vegetation in behind the barrier. But again, for the most part, it's a sandy shore upper tidal and a mixed sediment lower tidal. See that well along here, but it's a sort of a vegetated low scarp, 1 to 4 meters high, with a fringing sand beach and intermittent marsh in the coves. Tidal at this time at 1445 is less than 50 meters wide. There's some people down there for scale walking along the beach, and we're just coming up on Cardigan. These several ridges extending offshore here, which are either coarse substrate or an old break wall.
We just pass over the town of Cardigan. It's October 13th at 1445 hours through the causeway and the small outlet. We're just swinging around on the head of the Cardigan River. following the Cardigan River down past the settlement of Cardigan. You can see this small outlet going underneath the road that may also be a fish ladder, because there's a fishery up above the road. You can see the shallow harbor on either side of the river channel, which cuts through these barriers. It's quite shallow to either side of the river channel, so the boats would have to follow the winding channel out of Cardigan River. Low tide is at roughly 11:45 or a bit later, so we're on the decreasing tide. You can see just in the shadow of the trees on the monitor is approximately where low tide is. So we're about halfway, a little more than halfway. The back shore is loose trees, sand, erosional bluff, maybe 1-2 meters high. The sandy shoreline pretty well everywhere in the small embayments. We've got marsh and a vegetated shore. At the small headland we just went by, you can see there's a more of a predominance of the permacarboniferous bedrock, the sandstones. In the intertidal, there's some coarse material, but it's primarily a sand and mud. Coming around a small spit that's been prograding out into the river. Drops off fairly sharply on both sides of it, so it's going across the platform. We're just starting to pick up the aquaculture activities as we go by Crawford Point. Into an area of extensive marsh and more extensive intertidal as well. More shorebirds, and there is a predominance of coarse material in the intertidal zone. Looks like erosional bluff of about 2 to 5 meters along here. Going up into that inlet, you can see there's some marsh development, but it's mostly intertidal with a vegetated backshore, very low wave energy. There's quite a bit of loose log debris along the shore, which would cause problems in a cleanup situation. Some people have been dumping various amounts of debris in front of their property. This is known as Seal River. You can see the Seal River just coming into Cardigan River and the bridge which crosses over it. Wide intertidal and marsh. You can see the erosional bluff along here. Just on the corners primarily, and then it goes down into a low line, the sand beach, some dune grass in the back of that area. A little bit more gravel towards the headlands at the storm limit. Here you've got maybe almost 10 meter high bluff. Near Newport. Just coming up on Newport in a minute. Slide of the Newport area, slide 24. Film for. Coming up on the wharf at Newport. Either side of it, there's sand on the inner side and more gravel and storm ridge deposits on the seaward side. Back in an intermittent erosional bluff. some areas where there's properties that put some riprap and crib work down at the base of it.
Just coming by a small coastal foreland with some marum grass, more sand deposits. You see the upper intertidal is quite sandy. Down below that you're getting into more mixed sediment. Up near the intermittent bluffs you're getting more coarse material. And in this extensive marsh area and behind a narrow sandy barrier, quite heterogeneous material in the lower intertidal. We're just coming up on Campbell Point. Cliffs here around 3 to 4 meters high. Narrow fringing upper beach and then sort of extensive intertidal with a fair bit of vegetative matter. A cottage development, it looks like, along here. Quite an extensive fringing sand beach. Intermittent cliff increases anywhere from 1 to 2 meters all the way up to pretty close to 8 meters high. As we come up to the Gros Marsh, you can see again a narrow barrier, very extensive intertidal bed form, sandy. You see just the tidal channel coming up into the marsh just here. And there's a marsh. It's fed by Mosquito Creek, I believe. And just coming up to the point, you've got the glacial till over bedrock.
Like a fair bit of erosion. There's estimates of erosion of anywhere from 1/2 foot to 1.5 feet per year in this area. I think that's on the outer coast though. You can see some of the steps and various things have been washed away, or they've been putting up debris to save the shoreline. So primarily sand, there's some bedrock outcrops. So the glacial deposits might not be as thick as they look at first glance. Along here, pretty well sand intertidal. Extends anywhere from about 50 meters to 200 meters offshore, depending on where you are in the promontory. You see the sort of welded rigid runnel or welded bars. Intertidal flats close to shore. In the troughs you've got more gravel and on the highs of sand, of course.
Along the outer part of Cardigan Bay, we're in sort of the shoreline of Launching Bay, it's known as. You can see this fringing cliff ranges anywhere from 3 to around 8 meters. You can see trees falling over the edge. There's not a lot of riprap developed at the bottom, though. At the base of these cliffs, there's much more narrower intertidal, but as we get farther up into Launching Bay, or farther seaward, you'll see it increases in width again. Here you get more boulders at the base of the cliff. The intermittent low-lying marsh areas with this sort of vegetated mat along the storm swash limit. There is much more extensive intertidal.
Road and wharf at this point here near landing place. We'll just do a swing back looking down Cardigan River. Get a better view of the coastline. see the extent of intertidal flats, and particularly in the in behind this barrier that goes across to Broughton Island. Slide 26 of Broughton Island. It's all built up here pretty well above high tide. Dune grass, a bit of sort of a marsh grass in the middle, but it's primarily dune grass, sand beach, deeper at the northern end, and then you've got considerable deposition and intertidal bed forms in close. Okay, cool. Okay, it's a long view of Broughton Island. A small wharf just at this end of the island. The backside of the island has to be glacial deposits, fairly thin over the bedrock. In the intertidal, you've got some bedrock exposures by looks of things, vegetation around the sort of cobble lag. We got one of these promontories with the marsh in behind the sand barrier, formed by waves coming out of Cardigan River, Cardigan Bay area. Again, dune grass, very low ridges, some marsh deposits in behind.
On the landward side of Broughton Island, you've got pretty well continuous cliffs. Cut into sort of glacial material, ranges anywhere from 3 up to 8 meters. The crest height of Broughton Island is around probably 15 meters. Here you've got quite a narrow intertidal, sandy fringing beach with coarse material at the base of the cliffs and at low tide. It's about 9:40 a.m. October 12th. We're flying around 300 feet at about 40 knots. Hey, you can see the intertidal varies in width. I'm starting to see more bedrock being exposed both in the cliffs and in the intertidal. There's a good example of rock exposures in the more cobble boulder material. Coming up towards Broughton Point, in behind the shelter of the point, you're getting more sand accumulations, sandier bed forms in the intertidal, and you get some dunes up in the trees. Get much more sandy bed forms. Joining the main part of the island to Broughton Point is a well-established tombolo with a pond in the middle. Trees are on the seaward side. Broughton Point itself has the glacial deposit anywhere from 3 to 8 meters elevation, erosional scarp to it, very narrow fringing beach with a wide rock platform in the intertidal. As you get to the exposed seaward end of Broughton Point, of course, the tree growth has diminished considerably. Sitting on, a wide, rocky platform. And there's a good view looking northward along Broughton Island and the Tombolo. Erosion rates are indicated to be around 0.5 foot to 1.4 feet per year based on air photo interpretations, which is certainly indicative here of these erosional bluffs. Glacial material for the most part sitting on top of bedrock. There's a tombolo, a fairly well-established sand beach with dunes in the back shore. Along the seaward side of Broughton Island, you've got variable width of sand beach and rock platform.
You can see a lot more trees falling in over the cliff here. A lot more seaweed and growth from coarse material up on the beach as well. As we approach the main barrier fronting Launching Bay, you can see the much wider rock platform fringing Broughton Island. I'm just coming out on the barrier beach now. Just coming across the spit development, or the barrier that's developed across Cardigan Bay to Bruce Point. It's quite an extensive beach now with fairly extensive intertidal sand flats at the north end of the barrier. Just coming up on Bruce Point according to the topo map. And we've got quite an extensive lag from the erosion of that point. Probably one of the sources of the sediment for the barrier, adjacent barrier. The harbor is launching place. Launching place, you can see quite a difference in the beach on the south side versus the north side. North side's quite an erosional bluff and lag, whereas on the downdrift side there was quite a bit more sand. They're up, I guess, might be updrift in this case. Here you've got intermittent bluff and low-lying area, fairly good access by road and through various residential areas. Small ponds which have been sealed off by a sand beach. You get these intertidal ridge and runnel fires and transverse fires attach the bleak bars to the shoreline. Just coming up on Broughton Bay.